Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And today we are continuing with the Bhagavad Gita series. We have reached the 9th verse of the 2nd chapter. Alright, so if you have not watched the other videos, then please go and watch it in this playlist. And Arjuna's situation is not very good. He is full of grief and his senses are drying up. That is what he said. And we saw how we can solve the four primary problems of life, which is Janma, Mrityu, Jara, Vyadi. Okay, birth, old age, disease and death, only by using spirituality. There is no other alternative. So now, we will start with the 9th verse. And we will offer prayers to our gurus who have blessed us to get this divine knowledge. Om Gyan Timirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namah. Alright, so now, and as usual, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to it. And if you want a consultation from me, then please go down to the description section of my videos, where you will find the link to my website. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you will find Him. Just like Arjuna had found Krishna. I mean, Krishna was already there, but still he found Krishna again. So now, Sanjay starts speaking here. So you know who is Sanjay, right? So Sanjay is the one who is narrating the entire conversation, or he's narrating all the incidences which are happening in the battlefield of Kurukshetra in Hastinapur to Dhritarashtra. Okay, so Dhritarashtra and Sanjay are sitting in Hastinapur, and they are Vyasdev has blessed Sanjay that now I bless you that you can have this Divya Drishti, which means the divine vision, where sitting in Hastinapur he was able to see everything that was happening in Kurukshetra. Okay, so the 9th verse of the 2nd chapter is as follows. Sanjay uvacha evam uktva rishikesham gudakesha parantapa nayotsya iti govindam uktva tushnim bhavatuha babu bhuvaha. It's a bit difficult. Alright, so Sanjaya said, having spoken thus, Arjuna, chastiser of enemies, told Krishna, Govinda, I shall not fight, and fell silent. Which are the words which are used here? The word Rishikesh is referring to Krishna. Okay, so Sanjay Vacha, Sanjaya said, evam means thus, uktva means speaking, Rishikesha means unto Krishna, the master of the senses. Gudakesha means Arjuna, the master of curbing ignorance. So Gudakesha is a reference to Krishna, to Arjuna, which means that he could get away with his sleep, okay, even to learn archery to fight. Okay, that's what Gudakesha means he could not sleep and fight. And Rishikesh means Krishna. And Parantapa means the chastiser of enemy, which means it's referring to Arjuna himself. Na yotse, I shall not fight. Iti, thus, Govindam, unto Krishna, the giver of pleasure to the senses. Uptva, saying, Tushnim, silent. Baba Bhuva, became. Ha, certainly. So he has fell silent and he has totally surrendered. So now the purport is as follows. Dhritarashtra must have been glad to understand that Arjuna was not going to fight and was instead leaving the battlefield for the begging profession. Now why he would have been glad? Because if Arjuna would have not Arjuna did not fight, then the Kurus would have overpowered the Pandavas very easily, and then Duryodhana and the Kauravas would be victorious, Duryodhan and company. And then Dhritarashtra would be very happy because then his most beloved son, Duryodhan, would sit in the throne of Hastinapur for eternity. At least it seemed so. And instead leave the battlefield for the begging profession. So Arjuna would start begging, because that's what Arjuna said in some verses before, that it's better to stay by begging than to kill these great personalities like Bhishma and Drona. But Sanjaya disappointed him again in relating that Arjuna was competent to kill his enemies, Parantapa. So Sanjaya is very intelligent. He says that Arjuna is Parantapa. Okay, I mean, Parantapa is one of the names of Arjuna. So Sanjaya indicates that don't celebrate, all right? Because Arjuna still can kill. And Sanjaya deep down inside knew that Lord Krishna would not let this happen. So Sanjaya was indirectly hinting that although Arjuna has put his Gandiv down, but he is still Parantapa, which means he can still fight. There is a chance because Krishna is there. Although Arjuna was for the time being overwhelmed with false grief due to family affection, he surrendered unto Krishna, the Supreme Spiritual Master, as a disciple. This indicated that he would soon be free from the false lamentation resulting from family affection and would be enlightened with perfect knowledge of self-realization or Krishna consciousness and would then surely fight. Thus, Dhritarashtra's joy would be frustrated. Since Arjuna would be enlightened by Krishna and would fight to the end, so Sanjaya is hinting to Dhritarashtra that Arjuna has now surrendered to Krishna ultimately. And now Krishna will enlighten him, because of which he will again start fighting. Okay. So you better not celebrate too much. And then we will continue with the 10th verse. So let us read the 10th verse here. Tam uvacha Rishikesha prahasan iti bharat iva bharata senayor ubhayor madhye vishidantam idam vacha. The translation is, O descendant of Bharata, at that time Krishna smiling in the midst of both the armies spoke the following words to the grief-stricken Arjuna. So, O descendant of Bharata means, this is referring to Dhritarashtra because he is the descendant of the great king Bharat. Bharat is the son of Shakuntala. Okay, as they say, Shakuntala Putra Bharat. And from him only Shantanu and all the other great kings have descended. And that is why he refers to Dhritarashtra as the descendant of Bharata. Okay. Now, the word Bharata is also used for Arjuna because he is also the descendant of Bharata. Okay. So, sometimes the word Bharata refers to Dhritarashtra, at times it refers to Arjuna himself. Senayor Ubhayor Madhye, which means in between the two armies. Okay. But Krishna starts smiling. Why does Krishna smile here? That's a very beautiful point. See, till now what was happening? Arjuna and Krishna were behaving as if they were like friends. Okay. But now what happens? Suddenly, that friendship has turned into a guru-disciple relationship. And Krishna is amazed at this, which means he is very happy that now he can enlighten Arjuna. That was the main purpose of his birth. to speak the Gita, of course, and to kill the demons and to annihilate the miscreants and to restore dharma. And that he does by killing all the people in the Kurukshetra war who is in the side of the Kurus, the side of irreligion, adharma, okay. And how does he reinstantiate religion? Reinstall by putting Yudhishthir Maharaj in the throne. Purport. The talk was going on between intimate friends, namely Rishikesh and Gudakesh. Rishikesh is Krishna, Gudakesh is Arjuna. As friends, both of them were on the same level, equal. But one of them voluntarily became a student of the other. So Arjuna became Krishna's student. Krishna was smiling because a friend had chosen to become a disciple. As Lord of all, he is always in the superior position as the master of everyone. And yet the Lord agrees to be a friend, son, or a lover for a devotee who wants him in such a role. So although Krishna is behaving like this with the Pandavas, like a normal human being, but he's never at that equal position. He's always far beyond superior to everybody because he's God ultimately. And therefore, he agrees to be a friend like to Arjuna, or a son also at times. But when he was accepted as the master, he at once assumed the role and talked with the disciple like the master, with gravity as it is required. So the guru is sometimes very heavy. One of the meanings of the word guru is heavy. Okay. It appears that the talk between the master and the disciple was openly exchanged in presence of both the armies, so that all were benefited. So the talks of Bhagavad Gita are not for any particular person, society or community. They are for all, and friends or enemies are equally entitled to hear them. So this gives us an idea of how the relationship should be between the disciple and the guru and the spiritual master. Okay. So which means that externally, as Krishna and Arjuna, they are of the same age, so they are friends. So they are behaving as if, Arjuna is behaving with Krishna as if he's just like another person. Okay, so similarly, when we are behaving with our guru, we may behave as if, the guru is just like another person, like you or me. But that is not what the guru is. The guru is always at a superior position because the guru is the one who is giving spiritual wisdom. And therefore, the guru should always be respected and there should be reverence for the guru. Otherwise, we cannot accept spiritual knowledge. We will just hear it theoretically and we'll just let it go. Okay. So, Arjuna is demonstrating the most important principle or spiritual elevation, that is to be respectful towards the gurus and to be humble enough to admit that I don't know anything. That's what Arjuna is doing. He's telling that, my Gandiva has slipped. I can't do anything. Surrender. So surrender is the most important principle of spiritual life. One who cannot surrender can never accept spiritual knowledge. Because that person will always doubt the guru. Because if we think we know more or we know something at all, what to speak of knowing more, if we think we know something, then the guru's mercy cannot flow. It is blocked. But if we understand that we actually don't know anything and we humble ourselves, not humiliate, humble, and then we listen from the guru. Only then the guru's words will have some effect on our consciousness. Otherwise, if you are just arrogantly going on asking questions, oh, it's like this there, it's like this there, why is like this, why is like that? That doesn't work. It has never worked and it will not ever work. And it cannot work and it should not work. Because that is not how spiritual knowledge is imbibed. It is not theoretical knowledge that somebody is just speaking something, you are listening and you are understanding. We have to imbibe it in our consciousness, and that only happens when, as the example is given of a sponge, you know. So for example, I have this sponge here, okay? So if there is already a lot of water, then I can't use this sponge. I have to throw out all the water, and then when I want to use this, I can use this. I can suck out all the water from any other place using this sponge. Okay. So the more we think that we know, the more we are actually away from true knowledge, true self-realization. Okay. Because we have been living in this material world from so long, and our consciousness is so covered. It's like the smoke which is coming out. You see? This beautiful agarbatti, this dhua is coming out. Dhua or what, I don't know. But when I saw this coming, I suddenly felt the material world is also like that. Alright, so we have to humble ourselves in front of the Guru. Only then there is some possibility of spiritual inquiry, successful spiritual inquiry, alright? So that is the greatest principle of spiritual elevation. It is not in reading shlokas, memorizing shlokas, understanding big scriptures like Gita or Ramayana, Mahabharata or Bible or Quran or anything else. It is not in going to big spiritual communities. It is not in, you know, speaking about Gita to 1 million people and becoming a great preacher. It is not about that. The most important principle is we have to be humble and we have to inquire from our Guru. Then there is receptivity. Otherwise, it's just arrogance and question answers, like it happens in many places. We can go and many times people ask different questions. Oh, why did Krishna do this? Why did Arjuna do that? Why did Yudhishthira do like this? So they are not having any humility. They are just asking out of their arrogance or just for fun maybe. And then after some time, these people will go and tell that, you know, the Gita doesn't work, you know, scriptures are not good, don't read the Gita, become an atheist, don't believe in God, these kind of things they will say. But the problem is they have missed the point, all right? Gita is not a book of information. You cannot just go on stalking shlokas or information. That doesn't work. All right. So there you go. Thank you very much. And see you soon in the next verses. All right. Stay tuned.